Hello, this is Professor Gibson, and in this video, I'm going to be picking up where we left off last time and talking further about plant evolution, particularly evolution of the flowering plants, or the angiosperms. We'll start by reminding ourselves of some of the key innovations that we talked about last time regarding plants' evolution of and invasion of land, so cuticles, stomata, roots, shoots, vascular tissue, and all of those things. But when we get into the angiosperms, what really becomes important is to be thinking about the evolution of flowers and fruits, as well as changes that occurred in evolution of the seeds. We'll start by considering all of the different lineages of plants, just to put things in perspective. And so here you can see that phylogeny that shows the green algae, the bryophytes, the seedless vascular plants, the gymnosperms, and then over here, the angiosperms. Do note how these different groups, the bryophytes, seedless vascular plants, and gymnosperms, are not monophyletic groups. Those are actually sort of names that we put on groups of separate lineages that share all the traits that we find in those plants. Down here at the bottom of this phylogeny and in your notes, you'll be able to see the traits that have evolved at the different points along this evolutionary history of plants. But our real important focus today is to be thinking about what we see here, the flowers, the fruits, and this unique tissue called endosperm that we find in the angiosperm seed. We'll just start again by reminding ourselves of the plant life cycle, the alternation of generations, and how we have these two different parts, the haploid gametophyte phase and then the diploid sporophyte phase. And of course, remembering back as we consider plant evolution in the earliest plant lineages, the gametophyte was the dominant part of the life cycle with the sporophyte being dependent on it. And of course, as we go through plant evolutionary history, the sporophyte becomes more dominant and the gametophytes are dependent on it nutritionally. And so here we have some pictures showing just some generalized diagrams of the gametophyte and sporophyte that we'd find in bryophytes, ferns and the other related seedless vascular plants, the gymnosperm seed plants, and down here we've got a diagram showing you what's taking place in the angiosperms, and that's what we'll be looking at in greater detail in this lecture video. Just to see how the alternation of generation looks in these different species, you can see here the example in the non-vascular plants, the bryophytes. We've got our dominant gametophyte stage, and then how the sporophyte is eventually attached to it whenever it develops and dependent on this gametophyte. Likewise, we see the seedless vascular plant life cycle here, showing the same general kind of pattern. And finally, we've got the gymnosperms, showing how in these plants, again, we have, even with the dominant sporophyte phase here, we do have our gametophyte, which will eventually be part of the seed in these plants and nourish the embryo. And that's an important theme to think about in all of these three different groups of plants so far, is that the sporophyte phase of the life cycle and at some point is going to be nourished by the gametophyte. So either throughout the entire life of the sporophyte here in the bryophytes, for a short period of time while that sporophyte is just starting to grow and get established, it's fed by, it's nourished by the gametophyte here. And in our pines, we can look at these pine seeds here, so they're also called pine nuts. But what these are is gametophyte tissue surrounding a small sporophyte embryo. So when these seeds get put in the ground, they will start to grow, and that growing sporophyte seedling will get its nutrition, its nourishment from this gametophyte tissue that's stored in the seeds. But this is very different once we get to the angiosperms, the flowering plants. Things change dramatically, and we see some major reductions in the gametophytes, and also this new tissue that I mentioned before, the endosperm, or the endosperm comes in as a product of this unique process called double fertilization that happens in angiosperms. So we'll start off by reminding ourselves of the different parts of the angiosperm flower, how we have the outer parts, the perianth composed of the sepals and petals, and then we have the male parts, the stamens with the anther and the filament, and then the female parts in the pistil with the stigma, style, and ovary. And what's really important for the process of double fertilization is going to be events that take place in the ovary in these structures called the ovules. And that's where we're going to find our female gametophyte contained in the angiosperm life cycle. The life cycle of the angiosperms, a typical type of alternation of generations diagram that you've seen before. But we have this unique process taking place over here called double fertilization. And what that refers to is that the male gametophyte that you can see over here is actually going to make two different sperm. They're identical to one another, but it has two different sperm that are each going to fertilize a different part of the female gametophyte to produce an embryo and this tissue endosperm. So we'll start off by just thinking about what's taking place. So this diagram lays things out. You can see how in the anther, we have the process of cell division occurring. So inside of these pollen sacs, we eventually get this diploid microspore mother cell. It's going to undergo meiosis to give us microspores that will become four separate pollen grains. And each of these pollen grains is going to be made up of two cells. We'll come back to those in just a little bit. But let's look over here on the female side of things. So here we've got the ovary inside of the flower that contains this ovule. Inside of that ovule, there's a megaspore mother cell that undergoes meiosis to make four megaspores. Three of them will degenerate. One will survive, go through mitosis to make our female gametophyte. So this female gametophyte is contained within a structure called an ovule. So here's some pictures to show you what it actually looks like. This is inside of the anthers, and up here, let me change the color of this pen so it'll stand out a little bit better. So what you can see are the cells going through the early stages of meiosis, eventually giving us these structures which continue to divide, and you finally start to see the ultimate pollen grain divisions occurring down in here. So the cell divisions will take place, giving us mature pollen grains. You can see some scanning electron micrographs here, some light micrographs over here. So there's a lot of different types of shapes and features to pollen grains of different species. But what's important to look at is up here at the top. This is our mature male gametophyte up here. It's composed of two cells. One contains what we call the generative cell that has a generative nucleus. That's the sperm. And the other one is the tube cell. And it contains the tube cell nucleus. And this is going to form the pollen tube that grows down through the female tissues to deliver the sperm. Now to look at the female gametophyte, here's a cross-section through the ovary of a lily. You can see the larger sort of picture here. This is a monocot, so we've got the three different compartments, and we've got the separate ovules right here. But looking inside of these ovules, you can see the megaspore undergoing cell divisions, ultimately giving us four cells that divide further, and now we've got the female gametophyte formed here. This picture shows an actual micrograph of a female gametophyte inside the ovule, and then a diagram that's labeled over here on the side to help you understand exactly what you're looking at. All right, so now let's get to the process of bringing together the sperm and the egg. So first thing that has to happen is pollination. That's simply the pollen grain landing on the receptive stigma of the appropriate species. So pollination has occurred. And what happens next is this pollen grain is activated. It starts growing. And so this pollen tube will grow down through the style. Then its growth is being directed by this tube cell nucleus. And back behind, what's happened is that sperm cell has divided. So now we've got two sperm cells that are identical to one another, and they're going along with the tube cell nucleus as that pollen tube grows. You can see it continuing to happen down here. So here what's happening is the pollen tube has found the ovule. It's grown through an opening in the ovule. And what it will do is it will discharge these two sperm cells. One of the sperm cells is going to fertilize an egg, and the other one's going to go up here and fertilize two nuclei in this one larger area. It's called the polar cell, that with the two polar nuclei inside of it. Well, what this results in is you get a diploid zygote, so that's going to become our next sporophyte. And over here, we've got this triploid tissue called endosperm. And it's an exact twin. It's identical to the zygote, except that it's triploid. What the endosperm is going to do is become very metabolically active and basically provide nutrition to this developing embryo, provide nutrition to its developing twin. What this means is that the zygote is no longer being nourished by the gametophyte tissue. It's getting nourished by this unique tissue called endosperm. And so here's a larger sort of close-up diagram that shows you the process of double fertilization, the pollen tube coming in with one sperm nucleus fusing with the egg, the other fusing with these two polar cell nuclei, or also the polar nuclei of the central cell. There are a number of different names, but those are the two fertilization events that we're talking about in double fertilization. This just carries on to show how this this embryonic development process continues. This is just, like I say, filling out the process a little bit more. But what that leaves you with then is ultimately a seed. And in some seeds, like corn, you can see that there still is endosperm. So that endosperm tissue persists and it stays there once this embryo stops being dormant and starts to germinate and grow. It will draw nutrition and food from that endosperm. Whenever you're eating popcorn, that's what the fluffy white stuff is in the corn kernel, is the endosperm that would have been there to feed the embryo. Now, in other plants, we don't necessarily see endosperm remaining. So, if, for example, in this bean, the endosperm is not there anymore. It nourished the embryo during its early stage of development, but then as the seed developed more, the plant started putting nutrition into these structures called cotyledons. And so that, if you've ever broken apart a bean or a peanut, those two halves that you're getting from that seed, those are the cotyledons which are containing nutrition, which will feed that embryo once that seed begins to germinate. And so we'll finish this part by just saying, here is your overall diagram of double fertilization in the angiosperm alternation of generations, and you should now sort of understand what's taking place in all of these different tissues as we make the angiosperm seed. And so that's all I have to present for you here and give you that background on double fertilization. I hope that helps.